Hello, welcome to the lecture number 10 of quantum mechanics and molecular spectroscopy course. As usual, we will begin with a short recap of the previous lecture and carry on with the present lecture. In the previous lecture, we talked about the perturbation theory of the many states. Finally, using the first order approximation, we came up with the equation A of t of a state f, which is could be a final state, its coefficient will be equal to one over I h bar integral e to the power of minus I omega I f t integral f h prime t dt with some limit 0 to t prime. Now, what does this indicate? It indicates that if there is a two states, it indicates if there are two states, a initial state I and a final state f, okay, the transition from the initial state to final state and that coefficient is given by this equation. Okay. And you will also see that this transition from the initial state I to phi will be brought about this by this time dependent perturbation. Okay. Now, that is only the coefficient, but the probability is the square of the coefficients. Therefore, probability of transition to a state f will be equal to, now 1 over I h will be minus 1, but then probability always has to be positive. So, this will be 1 by h bar square e to the power of minus I omega I f t integral f h prime of t I dt modulus squared. So, it has to be a real number, a real positive number is what the p of t would be. So, this is the final equation. So, this is the probability and that depends on this integral, and it turns out that this integral also governs so called selection rules. That means under what condition you can start from initial state I and end up with the final state f. However, what we do not know as of now is this h prime t. Okay. Now, it is not very difficult to realize that h prime t or the perturbation Hamiltonian or the time dependent perturbation should come from the light. So, which means we need to look at light, and that is the content of our lecture number 10. Now, light, you know, can propagate, let us assume that it propagates along the x axis, okay, and then there is a vector or electric field that goes up and down like that. So, along y axis. Okay. So, your electric field vector is going along x and y axis, and you know that electric field vector will go up and down, something like that. Now, there is also a magnetic, corresponding magnetic field which goes in the z axis. something like that. Okay. So this is my z axis. So this along z you have this magnetic field. Y axis you have electric field. And this your x axis will be propagation direction. So the propagation direction, the magnetic field and electric field are mutually perpendicular to each other. Okay, right. Let us assume that there are three vectors that represent these quantities. Okay. Now, for propagation direction, there is a vector called r, okay, which is nothing but the radial vector. That means you are going away from some point. Okay. And there is an electric field vector, which I will call it as epsilon, okay, or epsilon like that. And there is a magnetic field vector called b. And these are unit vectors along that direction, and you will see the electric field vector will keep changing the direction. Okay? Once it goes up, then comes down and changes its sign and goes the other direction. Similarly, your magnetic field. But the propagation direction is along the x axis in one direction. Okay? That is not going to change its sign. Now, other thing that is important is something called wave vector. Now, wave vector is nothing but how many units of wavelength does the wave travel. Okay? Now, this is given by, wave vector is also called as k, and is given by 2 pi by lambda. Maxwell gave four equations. Okay? Those four equations are very well known, called Maxwell's equations, and this says del E or del dot E equals to 0. So let us call equation number 1. Then you have del dot B equal to 0. This is second equation. Third equation is del cross E equals to minus dB by dt, and del cross B is equal to mu naught epsilon naught minus dB by dt. Okay, where mu naught is permeability of free space, and epsilon naught is permittivity of space. Such that, okay, c square, that is speed of light, is equal to 1 over mu naught times epsilon naught. Okay. Now, that is the general description of the light in terms of Maxwell's equation. Now, the Maxwell's equations are associated with electric field and magnetic field. Okay. Now, the electric field, let us say E, okay, will have three components, Ex, Ey and Ez. This is in general, you know, light propagating in arbitrary direction. Similarly, one of them could be zeros. Say for example, if it is traveling along x direction, then y, it will either have y or z or yz, it will be in yz plane. So, Ex will be 0, okay, something like that. So, you have B will also have Bx, By, Bz. But you see, Maxwell's equations are only 4 equations involving E and B. Okay? So, we know Maxwell's equation is del dot E equals to 0 and del dot B equals to 0 and del cross E is proportional to d B by dt and del cross B is proportional to d E by dt. Okay, I've just omitted the constant constants, but you'll see there are 6 variables. And there are 4 equations. So, there is some somewhat of redundancy in the number of variables. Okay. But that is not really the point that I would like to capture. The most important point that I want to say is that when you treat Hamiltonian, okay, the Hamiltonian has kinetic and potential energy terms. Okay. So, Hamiltonian it has kinetic energy plus potential energy. It has no concept of field, and what the classical light is saying, it has electric field and magnetic field. But what we want is kinetic energy and potential energy. So, we need to convert these electric fields and magnetic field into appropriate potentials. That is what we need. Okay? So, now we make a transformation. Okay. So, in the transformation, we start describing the electric field and magnetic field or the classical wave light in 2 other quantities called vector and scalar potentials, because we need potentials and not fields. Okay. So, we make an alternate description of this and we get to what is known as scalar and vector potentials. Okay. Now, this will turn out to be phi is 1, that is a scalar potential. Scalar potential just means that it is a number. Okay. And there is a vector potential A, and this will have 3 components Ax, Ay, Az. Okay. Totally, we have 4 variables. And now, what you are going to do to move from electric and magnetic fields to scalar and vector potentials, you are going from 6 variables to 4 variables. That means, once again, you have redundancy. So, there will be infinite number of possible combinations in which you can reduce 6 variables to 4 variables. Okay. Now, you can take some physically important fixations. So, I say I want to fix this quantity, I want to fix that quantity, and then you can reduce the number of possibilities. Okay. And in electrodynamics, this is called gauge fixation. Okay. And for this course, we employ what is known as Coulomb gauge. C-O-U-L-O-M-B, Coulomb gauge. Okay. Now, before that, we also need a relationship, before we do the gauge fixation, we also need a relationship between the electric field, magnetic field and the scalar and vector potential. So, your electric field E is given as minus del phi minus dA by dt, and your magnetic field B is given by del cross A. Okay. Now, then we have, I told you there are 4 variables, phi, Ax, Ay, Az, and these have to be fixed from 6 variables of okay. Now, then we use something called Coulomb gauge in which, okay, It is a constraint, okay. Coulomb gauge is a constraint in which we say phi equals to 0 and del dot A equals to 0. So, this is the Coulomb gauge. Coulomb gauge fixes these two quantities, okay. Now, when I fix these quantities, then your E becomes minus dA by dt, just A is just time derivative, okay, and B will be equal to del cross A, okay. Now you can see very simply the following, okay. Now the vector potential is time derivative of E, and B, which is the magnetic field, is nothing but the curl of A, okay. That means that B will be in perpendicular direction with respect to E, okay. Now we have three vectors. By the way, E, let us say we have a unit vector, we had unit vector epsilon for E, and you had unit vector B for magnetic field, okay. And turns out that A will also be along the unit vector epsilon because it is just the time derivative. So, the direction is not going to change, but del cross A is the curl, so it is going to change, okay. So, A will be perpendicular to B, that means vector field A will be perpendicular to magnetic field B. So, what is perpendicular to the magnetic field B? The electric field. So, the direction of the electric field and the vector potential will be the same. However, they are going to be, even the direction is same, they are not going to be same because A, that is the vector potential, is a time derivative of E, okay. Then you have the wave vector K, which tells you the propagation direction. So, which means totally what you have is that your K vector is perpendicular to E vector, which is perpendicular to B vector. So, all the three, the rotational propagation or the wave vector, the epsilon, that is the electric field vector, and B, that is the magnetic field vector, all three will be perpendicular to each other. Oh, okay. Now, very generally, let us take A vector, A should be equal to A naught some maximum into epsilon, that is going to be the unit vector, okay, e to the power of minus e to the power of I k dot r minus omega t plus e to the power of minus I k dot r minus omega t. Okay. Now, k dot r is nothing but the dot product of the wave vector and the propagation direction, which simply means that the propagation vector and the wave vector all along the same direction. So, which simply means that this term is now called phase factor. Now, if you remember the classical wave equation, this is nothing but your alpha. Remember alpha was 2 pi by x by lambda minus nu t. Now, if I convert this, okay, 2 pi into x by lambda minus 2 pi nu into t. So, this is nothing but 2 pi by lambda is k vector x. Let us say the direction of propagation is x, but it could be r. So, r generically minus 2 pi nu is omega and t. So, that is exactly what you have here, okay. Now, if I want to write A, okay, let me write once more, A naught epsilon e to the power of I k dot r minus omega t plus e to the power of minus I k dot r minus omega t. Okay. Now, this is nothing but e to the power of I theta plus e to the power of minus I theta, this is cos theta. So, this can be equal to 2 a naught epsilon cos of k dot r minus omega t. Okay. Now, where you know I only told omega is angular frequency. R is propagation direction, and k is wave vector. Okay. Now, in the Coulomb gauge, or in general, E was equal to del phi minus dA by dt. Okay, and my A is equal to A naught into e to the power of minus I k dot r minus omega t plus e to the power of minus I k dot r minus omega t. By the way, this is also called plane wave representation. Okay. Now, this is nothing but if I take E, okay, so E will be the first derivative of this with respect to time. Okay. Now, you will see k dot r will be constant and minus omega t will be just be the this one. So, this will be A naught omega into epsilon divided by e to the power of I k dot r minus omega t minus e to the power of minus I k dot r minus omega t. Okay. Now, this is nothing but this is, if you see, this is cos theta. So, this will be equal to sin theta, okay, proportional. Okay. So, this will be 2 a naught omega epsilon sine of k dot r minus omega t. Okay. And this also can be written as, okay, there is a negative sign, I am sorry, because when you take a derivative, this will be minus omega t will have negative sign, so there is a negative sign. So, this I can write it as E naught epsilon sine k dot r minus omega t, where E naught is equal to minus 2 A naught omega. I have now started looking at the thing as electric field and vector potential. Okay. So, the vector potential and the electric field are time derivative with respect to each other. So, you can see that the vector potential is cos theta function and the electric field is sin theta function. And you know sin theta and cos theta have a phase shift of pi by 2. So, therefore, the vector potential A and the electric field E are out of phase with respect to each other by pi by 2, that is 90 degrees. So, whenever the electric field goes up, the vector potential comes down, and whenever the vector field, sorry, electric field goes down, the vector potential comes up, and the other way around. Okay? So, the electric field and the vector potential are time derivatives with respect to each other. And one can give a classical analogy of the, you know, harmonic oscillator or pendulum. Okay? Now, when you take the pendulum and go to the top, so let us suppose there is a pendulum and it will move like this in a harmonic path. And okay, let me redraw it. Think of a pendulum, okay, which has movement like that. Okay, this is the maximum. Okay. So, when you go to the top, you have maximum potential energy because the potential energy is away, you are moving it away. So, the potential energy will be maximum. However, when you reach here, okay, its momentum is zero because it is going to, if it went up, but it has to come down. Okay. Similarly, at the bottom, it will have maximum momentum because it has to go through this, but it has the minimum potential. Okay. So, the momentum and the potential, they are out of sync with respect to each other in the case of harmonic oscillator or a pendulum. This is the same in the case of the electric field and the vector potential. When one is maximum, other is minimum. Okay? We'll stop here and continue in the next lecture.